morning, friends. Merry Christmas. It is finally Christmas at Harvest. Just excited to be up here with you. We've been seeing baptisms every single weekend this entire year. It's something truly spectacular, and I'm looking forward to just the year in review of all that God has done throughout the life of our church. And specifically, I'm praying for our campus here that we might be able to see some new baptisms in the new year of new believers. And I just hope that you would join me in praying that as well. I'm going to invite you to open up to the book of Luke. It truly is Christmas when you're opening up to Luke chapter 2. We're going to be in a two-week series. This is going to be leading up to Christmas Eve services. It'll be at 4 p.m. And we haven't missed anything. We'll do the announcements. It's just going to be at the end of the service. So you'll hear a little bit more about Christmas Eve then as well. Well, my name is Jake. I'm one of the pastors here alongside Pastor Mike. And I'm relatively new enough that I feel like whenever I have an opportunity to be in front of you, I might be able to share a little bit about myself. And so one of the things you might not know about me is that I am a proud graduate of Taylor University. It's a tiny little school in Upland, Indiana. And do we have the seal? Yeah, like a good graduate of his school, I have absolutely no idea what the Latin on the bottom means. But I really did enjoy my time there, and the Lord really did use it. I graduated with a degree in biology. That's a story for another time. We'll have to tell you about that. It's out in the middle of nowhere, truly. It's in the middle of the cornfields. People make fun of it all the time, and if you're visiting there, everyone kind of looks around and be like, why did you pick this place? One of the reasons why I picked it is because you kind of make your own fun when you're in the middle of the cornfields. You don't have much of an option but to kind of be crazy and wild and creative. And one of those ways that it comes out is a little basketball tradition. Some of you may have heard of it. It's called Silent Night. CBS Sports said it was their second favorite basketball tradition in all of the nation. It's this little tiny town, Upland, Indiana, Taylor University. And so ESPN did a little special on it, and so I want you guys to be able to see what they said about it.
At tiny Taylor University, a Christian school 70 miles northeast of Indianapolis, silence is more than golden. It's tradition.
It's kind of weird.
A little bit.
In an age of ear-splitting arena speaker systems, of the constant assault on the auditory senses by scoreboard operators and pep bands, Taylor sets itself apart, at least one night a year, for a few minutes, with silence.
You're playing and you're seeing the people, but you're not hearing anything.
You hear people talking about it, how fun it is, but really, until you get to experience it for yourself, I really, really enjoyed it.
Every year, the weekend before December finals, Taylor plays at home, and the crowd, comprising the entire student body and most of the faculty, almost everyone in costume, does not utter a peep, emits not a sound, until the Trojans score their 10th point. Then... And still later,
so that's my little university. We're weird, but it's a fantastic tradition, and I show you that to kind of set this up. Silent Night is one of those spectacles that many people recognize. But it's a story that few treasure. And the reality is that most of the world knows about the basketball tradition, the 10 points of silence and the absolute bedlam that ensues afterwards. But what few people know is that afterwards is what the thing that most students cherish. After the game, we go down to the dining commons. We decorate Christmas cookies. We have gingerbread house making contests. And the president and the first lady would read to us the Christmas story out of Luke chapter 2 to a bunch of college students in pajamas and costume. And that's what was the thing that was, that's the thing that was precious to me. But like the whole world knows this crazy tradition that we have. And the reality is that it's the week before finals, you're all exhausted and you just need a break. And so the school set this thing up for us and we just took it to another level. But it's a spectacle that many recognize and a story few treasure. The Christmas story is the epitome of a spectacle that people will recognize. I remember, I know that there was, Jesus was born in a manger. We all know that one. A religion got started. People got mad at red cups, if you remember that. Wasn't commercialized enough. We couldn't capitalize it on enough, so we added Santa into this. And if you don't think that this is a spectacle, that we haven't like taken this and gone a completely different direction with it, there's a 30-foot blue light teddy bear on Waukegan and Deerfield Road who's willing to fight with you. It's a huge spectacle. It's easy to get caught up in all of this, and if you're like me, familiarity with the Christmas story makes it a recognized spectacle rather than a treasured story. It doesn't have to be that way. This is the very true story of the most anticipated moment in all of eternity. The promised salvation the promised solution of the gap between God and man, finally here, God himself coming down to earth, fulfilling the prophecies, born of a virgin. So Heavenly Father, as we look again to your word, as we remember the true story of what you did in order to redeem us and rescue us, I just ask that you would help us look past the spectacle and closer to the story that you have given us in your word, that it might bring comfort and joy and hope and peace that it promises. I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're starting in the book of Luke, chapter 2, and I'm going to start verses 1 through 7 because I want us to, just, again, have that context. In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration when Quirinius was governor of Syria, and all went to be registered, each to his own town. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth. She gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in the manger because there was no place for them in the inn. This is the first point that we come across. The Christmas story is a message for all. A message for all. We're going to look at verse 8. And in the same region there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. Now before we get to the message, and I'm going to do this a couple times, I'm going to pause. I'm going to stop us. Because I want us to start looking past the spectacle of Christmas and deeper into the story. So how many of you, when you think of the shepherds, you remember this, and when you're remembering the story, the thing that you think in your mind is these dirty, downcast, like the people that no one else wanted to be around, the smelly shepherds. Raise your hand if that's something that, that's the thing that I remember. That's the thing, but the reality is that that's not necessarily the case. And I have it on good authority from a friend with a doctorate in New Testament studies that this may not be the case. But to back him up as well, this is from Daryl Bach's commentary on the book of Luke. The shepherds are often characterized as representing the downtrodden and despised of society, so that the proclamation of the gospel is said to have come to sinners. The evidence for this view draws on material from rabbinic Judaism. There are two problems with reading the shepherds as symbols of the hatred. First, the rabbinic evidence is late, coming from the 5th century. But more importantly, shepherd motifs in the Bible are mostly positive. The New Testament portrays shepherds in a favorable light, even describing church leaders with this figure. In the Old Testament, Abraham, Moses, and David were all shepherds at some point in their lives. Thus, the presence of shepherds is not a negative point. Rather, they picture the lowly and humble who respond to God's message. Even Jesus himself recognizes himself. He says that I am the good shepherd. And so there's kind of this mental image that you have in your head of shepherds, of these downcast, lowly, despised people. And so I'm just trying to shape that a little bit differently. Scripture tells us a different story of a group of people not working a despised job, but rather an unremarkable, common job. As if it to say it could have been anyone on any day, at any time, working any job. Could have been a group of mechanics, bank executives, nurses, a sales team, a bunch of accountants. That one gets me. Like, angels appearing in the midst of cubicles. Like, that's comedy to me. But God chose shepherds. So what did the angel then have to say? Verse 9, an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people." I'm pausing again. Get to the message. What did they say? What was the thing that the angels had to say, right? I want you to build this anticipation because I want us to look again beyond the spectacle into the story, beyond the spectacle and into the story that God has for us. Tim Keller, in his book, Hidden Christmas, says this, and I want you to look past that so common quote from the angel when it says, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy." This is what Tim Keller says. The angel literally says, "Do not be fearing, be perceiving, for I am telling you the gospel." This principle, behold, and you won't be afraid. If you take time to comprehend, to behold what is in the gospel message, it will remove the fear that has dominated and darkened your life to the degree that you truly behold, gaze at, grasp, relish, internalize, rejoice in the gospel. To that degree, the fears of your life will be undermined. The message is this, the message that the angel delivers. This is one of those linchpin moments, those key verses in all of Scripture, and we come to it in verse 11. I've got it boxed in my Bible. "For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." The message that is being delivered to all is the gospel. Jesus is here. This day, it just happened in the city of David, right over there. And the next seven words would have fallen like hammers. A Savior. Is this the Redeemer? The prophesied Messiah? The one that we have been waiting for thousands of years? The one whom God promised to us all the way back in the book of Genesis that he would crush the serpent's head? Could this be the fulfillment of Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6? "For unto us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." Is that the Savior that this messenger is talking about? A Savior who is Christ the Lord, the Anointed One, God himself. This is one of those things you should have captured in your heart and in your mind. When someone asks you, "What is the good news?" "Unto you is born this day." This is the gospel in one verse, verse 11. "For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." Unto you, these undeserving shepherds that didn't do anything spectacular, but the reality is it's also undeserving you. We did not do anything to deserve this unmerited favor that God has blessed us with. Jesus came to save. The hope of the world is finally here. The angel continues with this, "And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger." Why do they need a sign? I need you to allow my imagination to run wild again for a moment. Because this just seems like one of those moments in Scripture where if the angel is speaking to them, he's saying the gospel, the good news, and all of a sudden he's just like, "You're not getting it." And he's just looking at some blank faces. I'm hoping none of your faces are blank right now and that you're following along with me. But the I don't know if the angel gave them a sign for this particular reason, but it seems like he says, okay, and it looks like you need a sign. You're not picking up what I'm laying down. All right, let me make this a little bit clear for you. There may be some reasons that you might need a sign. Here's three. Maybe you're clueless. You're just absolutely unaware of what's going on. For many of you may know this, we just had our firstborn son, and things that come with a newborn are things like sleep deprivation. And many of you have been extremely gracious and brought us meals and have helped us out a lot in that way. But at some point, I must go and forage and hunt and gather yet again. So into the grocery store recently, and I stood in the aisle staring at all the things on the shelves, a list in my hand, and absolutely no idea what I was there for. I mean, utterly clueless. Like, just one of those moments where I'm standing there, and someone in the store came up to me and was like, "Do you need help?" "Yes, I do. Can you just walk me around and help me find all these things? Because it will take me 5 hours if you don't help me out." So maybe the shepherds needed a sign. Maybe you need a sign because they were just absolutely clueless as to what this angel was saying. Maybe they were unaware of the prophecies. Maybe they had not been told. Or maybe they were just confused. You know how sometimes if someone gives you verbal driving directions and you're just kind of like, "I think I know where I'm going, but I also have Siri." And you just need a sign to point you in the right direction. And you're just a little bit confused, and you just need a little bit more of a sign to help you get there. Maybe it's just confirmation. You're 99% sure, and you could probably do it all on your own, but that one extra percent is just a nice little nudge to get you going in the right direction. And I don't know if the shepherds needed a sign for one of those three reasons. It's not clear. And when you need clarity in your life and you feel like you're asking God for a sign, your sign is likely going to come from God's word, his people, or just some common sense. But sometimes the Lord might give you a sign. And the sign that the shepherds had was pretty significant. A baby lying in a manger in swaddling clothes. Not a super common thing. It would be as if you were leaving Chicago during rush hour, going northbound on the Edens. Super fun time. It's bumper to bumper traffic. God says, "I need you to go somewhere for me. And so I'm going to open up one lane the entire way there that will not be disturbed in any way, and you're going to be the only one driving on it. Everybody else stays in their lane, bumper to bumper, not really going anywhere. There's traffic and construction, and it just snowed. No one's going anywhere. But your lane is nice and clean and clear." That's the level of clarity that this sign brings for these shepherds. You may not feel like you have the clarity that you need or the sign that you want from God, but I promise you something, you will always have enough to carry out his will. So the shepherds have the message, they have proof from this sign, and as if one angel wasn't enough to instill great fear, the hosts of heavens cannot contain themselves and burst onto the scene in songs of praise. "And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, 'Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased.'" The praise is due. God is fulfilling his end game. And by the way, when we sing songs of praise together here in worship, and Tabitha and Witness, thank you so much for leading us this morning. When we do that together, this is the mirrored image of what takes place in the heavenly realms. Our songs of praise, our worship, our ascribing to the Lord his due worth and glory is clearly on display through each and every single one of us. Because of the message from the angel, we have this good news. Because of the message from the angel, we see God working out his plan. And because of these, there's praise in the heavens, and it can't be contained. They just got to break through. And because of the message, there's peace on earth. And peace leads us to our second point, a peace to receive. I'm going to do that thing where I pause and I go back. Because I don't want you to get caught up in the spectacle. I want us to go back to the angel and back to the command to fear not. And so I'm going to ask my friend Ethan to come on up here. Ethan and Abigail are dear friends of ours. They came up from Arkansas to spend some time and to meet Zeke. So you can just stand right here. Thank you so much. So when you think of the angels in this Christmas story, where do you think of them coming from? Whispered murmurs, just point. Where are they coming from? Right, up in the sky. But that's not what the scripture says. And this word appeared is a nearness and a closeness. And the difference between me being up here in the sky to Ethan, it's the wrong perception. Because what's actually happening is as if one moment the angel was not there, and the next moment the angel's right here. Fear not! Don't be afraid! I know I'm right here! And it's just this immediate closeness. And so just as if someone just appeared next to you in the seat that you are sitting in, that is the level of nearness. And so I don't know if you would not be afraid or would be startled if your neighbor just all of a sudden was like, fear not! It'd get me. Thanks, Ethan.
Yeah.
It would get me. It might get you. It's a nearness and a closeness. One moment there, the next moment, an angel of the Lord within arm's reach. But these were shepherds, tough, reliable workers who thought off thieves and wild animals. And I'm not talking about wild animals like, okay, our version of a wild animal is probably a rabid raccoon or a nutty squirrel. Like that's our level. Maybe a barking dog who you wish would be on a leash. Like, that's our level of a wild animal. That's not the kind of wild animal these shepherds would be fighting off. So here's some species that are endemic to the area of Israel at the time. Lions, bears, jackals, cheetahs, wolves, hyenas, leopards. And this is the night shift. So if apex predators couldn't instill fear into this crew, what would? What in the world could cause great fear to come upon these shepherds? So I have a dear friend. His name is Talmadge Lee Gerald. It's a super southern name. And he is getting his PhD in ancient Semitic languages and archaeology. He's an ancient Bible geek, and I love him for that. And so he and his wife Martha are dear friends of ours. And it just goes to show that guys always marry up. So I asked my buddy Tal, other than them being startled by, oh my gosh, there's a, like, right there next to me, why would they fear not? Why would there be a command to fear not? And so I texted him that, and I'm going to read you the text message he shot back to me, because I'm so thankful for him. He says this: well, first off, fear not and do not be afraid is the most commonly used command in the Bible, used over 300 times, I think. So it's a fairly common expression. Then being told to fear not could mean several things. One, the angels could have looked like they were described in Daniel and Revelation, being these huge chimera-like monsters. So they were afraid. Second is this: fear in the sense of reverence. You get a situation like you do in Revelation 19, where John bows in worship to the angel, and the angel tells him to get up because the angel is not God. Compare that to Joshua 3, where Joshua bows down to the commander of the Lord's army, the pre-incarnate Christ. And the commander of the Lord's army doesn't tell him to arise. Instead, he instructs him on how to worship him better. Take off your sandals. Fear not could mean to not worship them, since the command is always to fear the Lord. The Hebrew word and the Greek word for fear is as ambiguous as it is in English. The natural instinct appears to be to bow down and worship anything that seems remotely divine. You're also talking about people who make standing stones and worship them as idols. They'll pretty much worship anything. So what are we fearing? An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. I don't think it's scary monsters. I think it's a real sense of the lack of holiness that the shepherds have in that moment. That emanating from this one point where the angel of the Lord appears to them is God's very glory, shining so brightly. And remember, it's not coming from the sky down. It's coming from right in their midst, shining out from where he's at, delivering God's message and carrying with him God's glory. Just imagine the clear cutouts of shadows that would have been cast from each of the shepherds. Some of them may be hiding behind each other, just trying to escape it. The fear is born out of a severe sense of their lack of holiness in the light of a holy God. And so they go to bow and worship. But the angel says, fear not, don't worship me. I'm not the one who's deserving of worship. And our lack of holiness put us at war with God. And that war is remarkably one-sided. In case you need a little refresher, we were losing. Quite badly. So we needed peace. But peace could only come through Christ. The coming of Christ marks the beginning of the end of our war with God. It started in the garden, and it ends at the cross. In the only way that he can, God manages to win the war by surrendering himself as the sacrifice. That's total peace. The war's over. It's won. And we didn't do anything. And we were losing. This is great. But the reality is that we have to reconcile the fact that this isn't our daily experience. If the war is over, why am I fighting battles at home, battles at work, battles with God? The story says peace, but the spectacle of the season is rushed and anxious and overwhelming. I haven't been with you long enough here to know all the battles that you've faced this past year. And I'm not nearly enough omniscient to know that all of the battles that you're facing right now. But friends, I can promise you that God's not done molding you yet. And his peace is attainable. Here's a battle that I've been facing this past year. I have a fear of man that borders on chronic. You may think, well, that's not that bad. But this year it has been particularly difficult. Ways it plays out, I value people's opinions significantly more than God's. I need affirmation when my contentment could only come from Jesus Christ. I'm desperately wanting affection from people, even the people who have deeply hurt me. I'm not satisfied with performance reviews or encouragement because it's never quite enough, because it never really truly satisfies that need. It also plays out in my value of myself and others' abilities more than God's omnipotence. I get angry when people have failed, either me or the church. I worry about the future. This played out significantly this summer when we didn't really know exactly what was next for us, and we weren't sure where our son was going to be born. To the point where I put myself in the hospital because I had stomach ulcers because I was just like, I'm fine. And I was just afraid that provisions wouldn't be met. But praise God. Praise God for a Savior who brings peace. Because he does. And praise God for men who come alongside me to guide me and encourage me. Praise God for a discerning wife who's really been with me through this whole season. If it had not been for the peace that comes from Christ and men in my life guiding me, my wife being very patient with me, I could have been in a very different place. So how do we get to that peace? Seems a little bit unattainable. Sounds like you're saying, just do it. Just do the peace thing. It's better. When the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." And they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. And when they saw it, they made known the saying that had been told them concerning this child. And when all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart, and the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told them. Mary helps us to see how to receive the peace from Jesus Christ by making a choice to treasure. A choice to treasure. That's a remarkable thing to do when you think about Mary's past year. Let's do that. This has been Mary's past year, waiting like every other member of God's people, wondering if the Messiah would ever come. Shock to be chosen as God's favored one, that she might be the one to carry his son, the Savior of the world, as a virgin. That's shocking. Joy. Seeing God at work in Elizabeth's life and the life growing inside of her. Uncertainty. I'm betrothed, and I have no idea how Joseph is going to respond. Probably sick. She's pregnant, remember? Exhaustion. She's traveling from Nazareth to Bethlehem, probably by foot. Pregnant. Probably third trimester. That's exhausting. Hopeful. There's got to be an in. Somebody's going to take us in. Some family's going to see us and be like, no, you're pregnant. We'll go stay in the stable in the manger. Like, you take the room, please. Or at least some family, maybe, in the town that could take us in. Dirty. To the point where her baby ends up in a manger. It would have been so easy for Mary to let peace give way to fear, but she made a choice to treasure this all up in her heart and remember the good news of who this baby is. To treasure up, to take these things in. I want to give you a little snapshot. If you're not familiar, if you don't quite remember what it's like having a newborn, people say a lot of things about the newborn. He's so cute. He looks just like mom / dad, whoever side of the family it's depending on. Oh my goodness, he's so strong. You can tell that he's going to be smart. And the response of the owner of this newborn child is usually somewhere between two different thoughts, and they happen simultaneously. The first is, yes, he's all that and more. He's wonderful and fantastic and spectacular. And the other side of that is, sure, maybe, I don't know. He kind of eats and sleeps, makes a lot of noise, makes a lot of mess. That's about it. I don't know about the whole smart thing. I don't know about the whole, like he kind of looks. It's a little fun. Babies look a little funny. Mine's adorable, but babies look a little funny. But to add on to that, Mary has the shepherds coming in, calling him Christ the Lord, a Savior. So Mary's past year, she's had a year of uncertainty, and she's just pondering all these things and taking them all up. But she treasures up this moment. The angel said this is who he would be, that this is the promise. But then again, he's just an infant. And he's just demanding to be fed every 2.5 hours. But the shepherds come in. And they confirm what the angel had said to Mary. This is a Savior, Christ the Lord. See, every year ends in this way for you. You have a choice to let fear and hurry blind you to God's work, or you can choose to stop and treasure the peace of Christ. And it's not always easy. It's often hard. I need to actively stop myself or have someone else help me and ponder my own fear and internal dialogue so often, and particularly this year, and choose to treasure what God is doing here and now. And I'm not cured, but like the shepherds, I have a reason to praise. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told them. At the end of 8 days, when he was circumcised, he was called Jesus, the name given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. Friends, we have a reason to praise the Lord for what he is doing. In response to this message, all who heard it wondered in amazement. Mary treasured and pondered. The shepherds glorified and praised God, compelled to action by all that had transpired. And now they're just going back to work. I think with a little bit different attitude. And Joseph and Mary, in response to this message, were obedient. They called his name Jesus, Yeshua, a Savior. So the question for you is, how will you respond to the good news of great joy? You're not supposed to ignore it or let it become a spectacle. You're supposed to treasure it, receive the peace, and remind others through your praise. If this is a message for all, then it's a message for you. For unto you is born this day in the city of David, a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. What are you doing with this good news of great joy? Heavenly Father, I just ask that as we are in this season of remembering your coming to earth, remembering the sacrifice you made, remembering and seeing the ways in which you have changed and blessed us and given us a hope, given us an opportunity to have peace in the midst of so many other spectacles. Lord, I just ask that you would help us to hold fast to that this Christmas, to treasure every single moment, to see them as they are opportunities to praise you, to worship you, to make your name known, to ascribe worth to you. For you came for us, humbled, lowly, born in a manger, deserving of so much more. You gave us everything so we could have an eternity with you. And we would be remiss to not hold fast and treasure that message and share it yet again. Pray these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who came for us. Amen.